Today, we're going to continue our series on hosting a Gatsby site using AWS. In our previous video, we covered how to automate your build and deployment process for your website's code. Today, we're going to continue on the topic of automation and go over how you can automate the provisioning of your infrastructure using Terraform. Hi, I'm Phil Sparks with Guiding Digital. If you're managing multiple sites or want to be able to spin up temporary infrastructure for features and development, then being able to automate the provisioning of your infrastructure is a key piece of maintaining consistency and efficiency. Today, we're going to use Terraform to deploy our Gatsby site to AWS. Terraform is a framework that allows you to use infrastructure as code to provision cloud resources and infrastructure. The infrastructure that we'll be deploying today is an S3 bucket that is configured to host a website, a CloudFront distribution, a SSL certificate, and DNS records. This pattern is based on the concepts from my first videos on hosting the Gatsby site in AWS. So if you want to get more familiar with what we'll be deploying today, I'll encourage you to watch those videos first. So let's get started. The first thing we need to do is install Terraform. To do that, we can go to their website and click on the Download CLI button. Then on the Downloads page, scroll down and download the version for whatever platform you're using. I'm using Windows, and so I'll download the 64-bit version for Windows. From this point forward, the instructions for finishing the install is going to be a little different based on your platform. For Windows, the next step is to go to the place where you saved your download and then extract the executable. And then you either need to move it to a directory on your system that's already in your system's path environment variable, or whatever directory you add it to, you just need to add that to the path environment variable. I'm going to move mine to a new folder inside my program files directory. Next, I need to update my path environment variable. To do that, go to the Windows Start menu and start typing environment, and then choose the Edit System Environment Variables option. Then click the Environment Variables button, and then I'm going to add mine to my system variables. So scroll down, you'll see the path variable, and then click on Edit, and then add your new path to the bottom. Next, we need to switch to AWS, and we need to create our policy and user credentials that Terraform will use to provision all of our resources. So first, we'll create the policy. We'll navigate to the IAM section, and then go to the Policies link, and then click the Create Policy button. Then we need to add each of the permissions that Terraform needs to provision all of our resources. I'm going to follow the principle of least privilege and just give it the minimum permissions that it needs. I'm going to go pretty fast through this setup, and so if you need to pause the video, I'll also include the list of permissions you need to add in the README of the completed repo, and I'll include a link to that repo in the video description. First, we'll add the permissions needed for the S3 bucket. For each of the services, we'll give them access to all resources. Next, we'll add the Route 53 permissions. Then the Lambda permissions, then the permissions for the certificate manager, and finally the permissions that CloudFront needs. Then we'll click the Review Policy button and give our policy a name and click Create Policy. Then we'll create the user and credentials. So we'll go to the User section and click the Add User button, and enter a username. Then we'll select programmatic access for access type. Click the next button, and we're going to attach our existing policy. We'll select our policy and hit the next button, and hit next again, and then click the create user button to finalize it. Now we need to store these credentials somewhere that Terraform can recognize them. You have several options for storing your credentials. One option is actually storing them as part of your scripts, but I wouldn't necessarily recommend that for security reasons. Another option is you can export them to environment variables, or a third option is you can create a AWS credentials file in your home directory and Terraform will retrieve them from there. And so that's the option we're going to use. If you're using Windows, just back up to your users directory and then create a directory called .aws and then create a file called credentials. I already have one, and so I'm going to open it in Visual Studio Code and modify it, my existing one. Now I need to switch back to the AWS console, and I need to copy the AWS access key ID and also the secret access key to my credentials file. One thing to note about the secret access key, as soon as you leave the screen, you won't be able to retrieve that anymore. And so if you've already closed it or lost it, you'll have to go back and create a new set of user credentials. Now let's review the Terraform code before we deploy it. I'll include a link to the Git repo that has all these files in my video description. This video isn't meant to be a training video on Terraform, and so if you need a refresher on the syntax of Terraform and its purpose, you can go to their page and they have some good tutorials. They also have good documentation as well. For example, if you need information on how to write a script for S3 bucket, you can just type in Terraform S3 bucket, and their documentation page is usually the first one in the results. On their documentation page, they have example scripts, and then they list all their arguments that you can use in their scripts. Now let's go back to Visual Studio Code and review the files. The first file is the provider file. Here's where we set that we're using AWS, and we can also set the default region. The next file is for our DNS entries in Route 53. You'll see here two DNS records, one for our www and one for our root domain. Next, we have a file for our S3 bucket. The first section is to turn off the block for public access, and the next section is what we need for our S3 bucket and to enable the website hosting. The next file related to our S3 bucket is our bucket policy, and it will allow the public access to our objects in our bucket. One thing to point out here is it looks like my condition is commented out, but that is just the module that I have installed for my syntax highlighting. It's getting confused with the /*** on the previous line. The next file, I've put all the resources that are required for our certificate for our CloudFront distribution. The first line is for our zone. One thing to note is I'm assuming that the zone is already set up in Route 53. Next, we have a resource for the certificate. I'm using the DNS method for my validation. If you have to, you can validate by email as well. Just know that if you've set it to email, there'll be a manual step involved, and so you'll have to be able to receive the email, approve it before the script actually times out. The last two resources will actually create the DNS records needed in Route 53 for the validation. The next file is for our CloudFront distribution. So you see here where we're setting our origin, and also where we're setting here for our aliases. Don't forget to add both your www and your root domain. And here I chose to set the minimum default in max TTL to one variable, which I'll explain the variables in a second. And then you see here where I'm setting up the Lambda function for our redirect from our root domain to our www version of our domain. Our last file is our locals file. In this file, you can create local variables. You might set variables for things that are used more than once or things that are different from site to site. And so it just makes it easier to come to this one file to set the variable. One thing to point out, you'll notice that I'm pointing to the Lambda error in this variable here. Since the Lambda function can be used by multiple websites, I chose to not include the Terraform scripts in this project and just make it a project of its own. I'm not going to go over those scripts today, and so if you're trying to follow along, either create a Lambda function for your redirect outside of this video, or you can just delete the references to the Lambda function for now. So now let's use Terraform to deploy our resources to AWS. I'll open up a terminal, and the first command I'm going to run is terraform init. This command gets your working directory ready by pulling in the plugins and modules. In our case, the only thing it's pulling in is the AWS plugin. Next, I'll run the terraform plan command. This command compares your configuration files to what is set up already in AWS, and it will output a execution plan. You might want to use this command if you're just wanting to test your changes without any risk of actually deploying your changes. Now to actually deploy the changes, we'll run the terraform apply command. You'll see that it outputs the same execution plan as the previous command and then gives you the option to proceed or to cancel. We'll say yes and let it deploy our changes to AWS. It can take up to 20 minutes to deploy the changes. For this video, I've edited out the waiting time so we can see the results faster. And there you go, our resources deployed successfully. And now let's test our site. First, we need to upload a sample site to our S3 bucket. And so I've got an out-of-the-box Gatsby site I've already compiled. And so I'll move that up to my S3 bucket. Then I'll go to CloudFront and just check a few things there. We see that it added my aliases and certificate. So now let's open up a new tab and let's go to our website. And there you go, it came up successfully. Now I want to show you how you can delete all the resources using Terraform. First, we'll need to go back to our S3 bucket and delete all the files. The bucket has to be empty for Terraform to delete the bucket. One easy way to do that is just select the bucket and hit the empty button. Now let's switch back to Visual Studio Code and we'll run a Terraform destroy command. Just like the apply command, it'll first output the execution plan, which in this case is deleting everything. It'll ask you to confirm, we'll type yes, and then it will go through and delete everything. Again, I'm going to fast forward to the end so we can see the end results. And now all of our resources are now deleted.
Thanks for watching today. If you found this video useful, give me a like, and make sure and subscribe if you want more content on web best practices. Also, feel free to leave me a comment or question below, and I'll try to respond to each one. Thanks.